So pleasant good morning to all. So I'm very happy to welcome you all for the fourth day program of Atal sponsored FDP on earthquake resistant structural systems and design for buildings and structures. So today we have with us today, so a young speaker but an eminent speaker too. So we have Dr. Jagabandhu Dixit today to deliver his first session of today's program. So I'm very much happy to welcome Dr. Jagabandhu Dixit on behalf of all the participants present here. So welcome you, Professor, for this Atal FDP sponsored program. So I'm very much happy to introduce Dr. Jagabandhu Dixit to the participants. So he's an expert in the field of earthquake engineering, and he has been serving as an assistant professor in the Department of Civil Engineering at Shivnadar University, Delhi, NCR, since November 2012. And regarding his educational background, Dr. Dixit did his M.Tech Civil Engineering from IIT Guwahati, the year 2009, and PhD Civil Engineering from IIT Bombay, the year 2013. So for his M.Tech and PhD thesis, he worked in the area of strong ground motion modeling and seismic hazard microzonation. He is currently doing his research and supervising three PhD scholars in the area of dynamic soil structure interaction, natural hazards and disaster risk reduction, multi-hazard risk assessment with the primary focus on GIS-based multi-hazard mapping of spatio-temporal assessment of the vulnerability to natural hazards. To his credit, he has completed four major research-based consultancy projects in the field of multi-hazard risk assessment. At Shivnadar University, he has been teaching several postgraduate courses and undergraduate courses in the domain of structural engineering, geotechnical engineering, and earthquake engineering, including some university-wide elective courses, namely natural hazards and disasters and disaster management, etc. So we are very much fortunate to have Dr. Jagabandhu Dixit today with us. So today he is going to deliver a session on soil liquefaction during earthquakes, liquefaction potential assessment, and also liquefaction mitigation techniques. So welcome you, Professor, once again. And now I'm handing over the session to Dr. Jagabandhu.
So thank you, Professor Komata. And I'm so happy and glad that you have invited me for this wonderful talk. That is Faculty Development Program sponsored by Atal. And as you mentioned that I am serving as the assistant professor here for 9 years, and I have the total experience in this field of 14 years. But prior to me, so many experts have already spoken, having the expertise of 40 years, 40 plus years. So I will try my best to do a justice to the field and also to the topic. So I welcome everyone, and this is a very long topic. So before we begin, I thank you so much for joining this session. It is not a very pleasant scenario now. We are in the pandemic. Despite that, you have chosen to attend the session, and my sincere thanks and gratitude to Professor Komata for inviting me to this talk. And I hope everyone is safe, doing great. Now I'm sharing my slide. I hope it will be visible. Just a second. I have made it full screen, but here it is not showing full screen. I don't know. Is it showing full screen to everyone?
No, sir. It is in PPT mode only, like slide.
Yes, in
only one.
I'll spread it, everybody.
Yeah.
I think it is
visible. Yes.
Yeah. So good morning once again to everyone present here. So the topic for my talk is soil liquefaction during earthquakes. And again, there are two more topics added to this, that liquefaction potential assessment, liquefaction mitigation techniques. So each part of it is a kind of course in itself. And as you understand that earthquakes, this whole series is about earthquake resistant structural systems and design of building structures. And this is little odd in one sense that it is almost going to be revolving around geotechnical earthquake engineering. But so far what you have attended, the first one, I believe the title was related to introduction to earthquake engineering, which was related to engineering seismology more or less. And the others are in the field of earthquake engineering from structural engineering perspective. So here more or less we'll be talking about geotechnical engineering. But again, knowing that this is a faculty development program and the participants are likely to be from different domains, so I'll not assume any prerequisite of geotechnical engineering. I'll try my best to introduce the topic first, then get into the concepts. And it will be almost not so difficult, although it is from geotechnical earthquake engineering field. So with that, we'll go ahead. What exactly we'll be doing in this particular session is that we'll be trying to answer these six questions. That when has liquefaction occurred in the past earthquakes, that it's about when, then what, why, where, how, which. I was looking for other questions, but I had very less vocabulary, so I stopped here. So six questions: when, what, why, where, how, which. We'll start with when, means we'll be talking about that exactly when the earthquakes happened. So in the first part will be the first part of this, we are focusing about soil liquefaction during earthquakes. And now, when did it happen? Sorry. So as you see in these two pictures, that these are the effects of liquefaction which happened during past earthquakes. Because when we try to understand something, we go back to the history to understand what happened as a consequence. So here what we see, these pictures are quite famous, particularly the left one is quite famous. This is so widely used and it's a kind of general knowledge now. So no citation is required in one sense. So now in this building, what we see in the left, the buildings are almost intact. The structural stability is well maintained, but the buildings are kind of slipping. It's because of the lowering of bearing capacity due to the liquefaction of the soil below. Same happened, and this is in 1964 Niigata earthquake. And this 1964 Niigata earthquake is quite famous also for the other reason, because the structure was intact and it lost its bearing capacity. And after that, people started working on the liquefaction potential and soil liquefaction quite rigorously. Of course, the situation was there. Like even 1906 San Francisco earthquake, there was the liquefaction phenomenon, but nobody was paying attention till this date. 1964, this Niigata earthquake and 1964 Alaska earthquake gave an warning kind of to understand this liquefaction in great detail, the mechanism, and again followed by how we can mitigate it, etc. Similarly, in 1999, Izmit earthquake, that is your Kocaeli earthquake also is the name, in Turkey, that most of the buildings experienced the similar kind of phenomenon. The bearing capacity lowered and the building tilted. When the building is tilted, obviously the functional requirement is not served. Here what we see in these pictures, that the flow failure of lake in 1957 Dali City earthquake, that in the left, that it is just kind of just flowing. So there is a term called flow liquefaction, we'll try to understand that. So it is kind of flowing and leading to the damage of this. And in the right side, in 2004, that what we see, that the sewer pipes are coming out. Because when we have something quite heavy on the ground, they because of the lowering of the bearing capacity, they tilt. But in case there is any underground structure, they come out because of this buoyancy force that we have, and also because of the lowering of strength in the soil. Next comes the other effect. There again, all those pictures are quite famous. So the breeze in the, what we see in both the cases, the breezes that support decks are falling, whether it is during Great Hansen 1995 earthquake, that is also called as Hyogokin or Nambu earthquake, or Kobe earthquake, is more or less Kobe earthquake, everyone calls it that way. So in this, that because of the lowering of the bearing capacity, the piers were not in the position to take the load, and they tilted, obviously, and because of that, the upper slabs, they fell down. Similar was the case when 1964 Niigata earthquake, that the lateral spreading happened due to liquefaction, and because of that, the slabs also fell because they are supported on the piers. And here what we see, that the highways are cracked in this 1991 Lehman earthquake, also called as Costa Rica and other names that you see. So this, the soil below this road, this highway is liquefied, and because of that, we are having such a cracked phenomena seen here. Next, also in the 1964 Alaska earthquake, again, Niigata and Alaska, they are generally put together. In the same year, and after that, the research started as we discussed. So cracked highway led to, is because of the lateral spreading due to liquefaction. Now, the ground fissures, as you see here, that it is in 2010 Haiti earthquake, that these ground fissures due to this lateral spreading induced because of liquefaction. Induced by liquefaction is the cause. Here what we see in the right, in 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, that the river dike has failed. It's quite big cracks all over. Now in 1971 San Fernando earthquake, that there is also lateral spreading. So the common words I'm trying to pick here is, there is a pattern that lowering of a bearing capacity, then we had the crack in the highway, then we talked about lateral spreading there also, then here the damage to the retaining wall in the right. This is also due to lateral spreading induced by liquefaction. Now what we see in these pictures, the pictures are telling the stories, hence I'm a little fast because our journey is quite long. So the sand boil during 2001 Gujarat earthquake, also called as Bhuj earthquake. So what we see, this kind of potholes all over almost in this photo. And in 1964 Niigata earthquake, the sand boil. So it's a kind of craters that we find when we are doing any kind of compaction. Similar to that it looks, but the size sometimes is quite big. And here, the right one, again shows the sand boil in 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake. So it's not the names that I'm taking, they are just not the only examples that we are referring to. Sand boil means are not limited to these three earthquakes. Almost every earthquake which are quite major or great, sand boil has definitely happened in most of those events. Now the other phenomena during the earthquake induced liquefaction is the alteration of the ground motion. That when, in this picture particularly in 1964, the kind of time history we see, that acceleration time history, time in the x-axis and acceleration in the y-axis. So that, you see that the onset of liquefaction happens at 7 seconds. This is 0, 5, 10, and 7. So the 7 seconds, the earthquake starts, and from that liquefaction also starts. And you see the kind of ground motion it had before, right before this onset of liquefaction, is quite high frequency. and the displacement is quite low. On the right side, what you see, the frequency is quite less, but the displacement is quite high. Again, so this is what we are trying to understand. It caused the reduction in the stiffness of the underlying soil because of the high displacement that we are having, and the amplitude and frequency content are also altered. And this, if you that response spectra analysis that you must have understood by now in the other sessions or based on your background, that if you do that response spectra, that you will see for which you you need to have the kind of series of structures from single degree of freedom systems, and based on that you get that a peak of every response, and you connect that to get the response spectra, which gives you the frequency content. I'm just briefing it quite in a short. In that, so when you do that response spectra analysis, you will find that frequency content and the amplitude are all altered, and this is also clear in this picture. So here are the videos which will also tell us some stories. So the question, why did this happen? So as you see, there was that seismic wave which was traveling, and when it was traveling, obviously the shear wave, you understood that the primary wave, secondary wave, they transmit, and when they reach a particular type of soil, in this case the saturated soil which was cohesionless, the water in that void was trying to come out, because they always want to come out. You do that experiment, for example, you have some lump of sand which is soaked in water, you try to move around, that water will try to come out. You will have it, this is also the principle in washing machine, that when it rotates, the water comes out and you have the dry cloth. Similar way, so when that water tries to come out, and obviously when that water comes out and there is no passage left, then it mixes with the kind of soil. We'll talk about the mechanism in detail, and that leads to whole liquefiable medium right below the building, and the building undergoes that tilting or kind of significant deformation. So the next one here is an example from 2011 Christchurch earthquake. This will also give us the understanding. All the pictures are kind of summarized here.
Stories of survival, people with virtually no injuries, and others with horrendous injuries, as you'd be aware of.
Got two kids at home, asking their mothers, we want to be able to go ahead and just to look at that building.
I don't believe it. Why this building?
There's nothing for washing or toiletry or brushing your teeth, nothing at all. this is a gold, see, liquid gold. This.
Of our family members, see if they're all right, got food and water. We're really quite stranded, really. Roads are bad, obviously. Brisbane where they've had the floods, and I'm not sure which is the worst.
But we're not really sure where we're going to go from here.
It rock and rolls again tonight, we'll think about leaving.
So we had the brief understanding of what happens, and also when did it happen. Almost in all earthquakes, we see that the liquefaction is one of the phenomena happening during the earthquake. Now we'll try to understand what is liquefaction, or the next question, why does it happen? So both the questions put together is about the concepts of liquefaction. So just the kind of definition, we can say that the liquefaction is the transformation of a soil from the solid state to liquid state. The transformation is happening. The soil, obviously the structure that we are having when we built, that was on a strong foundation, obviously. And obviously for that reason, it was a solid medium, solid strata. And after this earthquake, and after that, the phenomenon that happens, it is liquefaction, is the kind of transformation of the solid soil to the liquid state. And that happens due to the increased pore water pressure. Water is there. When we have the structure in monsoon, or even the other days, the water, depending upon the situation or the location of a groundwater table, pore water pressure is likely. But it is about increased pore water pressure during that ground shaking. That leads to reduced effective stress, because we know that the total stress, this is from soil mechanics, the total stress is based on the effective stress and the pore water pressure. So when the pore water pressure is increasing, that leads to the reduction in effective stress, and hence the strength and stiffness of the soil gets reduced. In response to an applied stress, which we said that ground shaking during an earthquake, or other sudden change in stress condition. So the initial stress was something, it was loaded, it had the confining stress, it had overwhelming pressure. Now, because of this ground shaking, the pore water pressure increases, effective stress gets reduced. This is the summary. Now, this describes a variety of phenomena causing soil deformations due to sometimes monotonic loading, transient loading, repeated disturbance of saturated cohesionless soil. This it has to be saturated. If water is not there, then who will come try to come out? So water is supposed to be there. It has to be fully saturated, cohesionless, in undrained condition. Undrained condition, what it means that we have no proper path for the water to be drained. So in that case, it becomes undrained condition, resulting in the generation of excess pore pressure. So the excess pore pressure is important. You see, when water is there in the ground, it has hydrostatic pressure, which you calculate like gamma W. You have your gamma W multiplied Z or D. So that hydrostatic pressure is always there. But when you have this loading, monotonic, transient, and kind of repeated disturbances, the excess pore water pressure gets generated, and that leads to liquefaction. So here we talked about the loading, type of soil, saturation condition is to be maintained, has to be there as a kind of prerequisite. Then excess pore water pressure is the cause of this liquefaction. So let's take this kind of cartoon, the image that we have soil here, which is, these are the soil grains are not round, obviously, and they are not supposed to be uniform as well, but it's a kind of analogous we are putting, but soil particles are not this way at all. Now these are the soil particles they need not be layered in the very nice way they are layered. They are never layered this way. So when you have this soil which is saturated, the blue ones are representing water, water everywhere. Now, and the soil particles, all the voids are filled with water. There is no air inside it. And then what we are trying to do, we apply shear force to this soil specimen. So when we do this in drained condition, the shearing is happening and water tries to come out. When water comes out, because there is soil all around, and obviously the easiest path will be to move upward. So when it comes up, upward, the weight of water, and also because of this shearing, rearrangement happens and it settles. So in drained condition, the soil will settle and the water is there and it will evaporate because of the heat or whatever later on. So now the settlement happens in drained condition. That is the point. Now the other case, when we have this same scenario in undrained condition, that there is no way for the water to come out. In that case, what happens? That the pore pressure increases. That water, which the pressure which was building up, if it doesn't get its pathway out, then it will be pushing the soil to the extent that it becomes equal to effective stress. And the moment it becomes equal to effective stress, then obviously there is no stiffness. Okay. That next one. So this is the kind of mechanism due to this undrained condition we get this. The next part, when should we expect the liquefaction to happen, or where does it happen? In this part, we'll talk about the type of soil which are very much prone to liquefy, susceptible to liquefy. So you see, we have cohesive soil, granular soil or cohesionless soil, and this part what we see here are generally susceptible to liquefy. But again, with a kind of rider here, that the gravels are also reported to liquefy. Not that the gravel themselves liquefy. I mean, the kind of a phenomena we see in liquefaction, that happens. Now, I'm not talking about the gravel in itself, it melts down. Not that. The gravelly soil I'm referring to. Then the clay soil also are reported to liquefy, but most general ones are the silty soils, sandy soil, like that. And so the kind of classification, you know, that the fine grain and coarse grain soil. So these are the type of soil which are very much prone to liquefy. And again, here obviously the depending upon, I missed one point. So depending upon the type of code you are choosing, so the classification, the namings, everything will be different. And so just in brief, they are in kind of in a generic way, silt and sandy soils are susceptible to liquefy. That's the idea. We try to understand whether the soil is susceptible or not by understanding some of the criteria. The first criteria we generally try to refer is the historical ones. That if a site has liquefied in the past, it is going to liquefy in the future. So because of that, we go for the field study. Before the construction of the building, if we have any kind of ground investigation done, site investigation done before the construction starts, and we find that when we excavate, we find that, oh, there is the sand dike, there is sand boil, there is some identification marks which clearly shows that these are the liquefiable zones, liquefied layers, then we should understand that they may liquefy in the future. That is one. So field study will tell us that. We also use that prehistoric evidence based on exposed soil stratigraphy, which is also a kind of paleoliquefaction, a study in itself. And this paleoliquefaction or paleo study helps us to put to suggest that what could be the magnitude of earthquake. So similarly, we try to understand that this is the soil which has had liquefied in the past, and obviously this is, if there is no significant change is done to that ground after the liquefaction happened, then it will liquefy again in future earthquakes. If there is again ground rate table and all other conditions which are required for the liquefaction to happen. Next is our geological criteria, that it depends on the type of deposit that the soil is having. So in that case, if the soil is uniform, that we are talking about the soil grain size distribution, which we do in our, all of us definitely have the background of geotechnical engineering, even if we are more of on the structural side, but we have done in our BTech, MTech somewhere, our soil mechanics. In that soil mechanics, the first experiment is about particle size distribution. So there we try to understand what is the gradation and all. In that graph that we have, that semi-log graph sheet we plot, that we don't prefer the soil grains to be of uniform size. And if the soil is of uniform grain size and they are in loose state, then they are very much susceptible to liquefy. And the kind of soil deposit we are having also tells us the susceptibility. For example, if it is fluvial, alluvial, colluvial, the kind of deposit, it's because of the river, because of the season, because of the slope instability, in the sense that the soil is coming down and getting it is getting deposited at the bottom of the hill. So the colluvial soil, alluvial soil, that is because of the wind one soil. So they are the ones which are likely to liquefy. The younger sediments are also more susceptible to liquefy. And when we say younger, it's not very much of our kind of understanding of young or old. Here it is about 1,000 years. The young, even the soil deposit, which is around 5 to 10,000 years old, they are also treated as young. So in those cases, the soil type is, or the site is liquefiable. Then the depth of groundwater is very much important, because if the water is not there, then what is the point of talking about liquefaction? It is very much important parameter or factor. Next comes the compositional criteria, that what is the composition in that? So it's very much similar to the last one we talked about, but the primary thing we are talking about is, when we do that particle size distribution, we try to understand whether it is poorly graded, well graded, uniform graded, and which type of particle size is quite dominant. So based on that, we try to understand how much will be the susceptibility. And most liquefaction is observed in clean sands. And the most liquefaction failures have involved uniformly graded soil that we talked about in the past. Rounded soil particles are more susceptible than the angular ones. So when we are talking about the angular and rounded, we are directly referring to the soil particles. I mean, not necessarily the ones in that we studied in clay mineralogy or that part. Just the soil grains we are referring to. So this would be angular, and angular ones, that also is part of transportation engineering, that angular ones are always better for the locking. Similarly, in this case, the angular ones are less susceptible than the rounded ones. The other criteria is state criteria. State in the what we mean in this state criteria is that what is the present state of stress? How much it has, how much stress it has, applied in the past. Now, how much is the stress level? So the stress and density characteristics at the time of earthquake is quite important. So in soil mechanics again, So you know the term called consolidation, the chapter called consolidation. There we talk about different state of soil, whether it is dense, whether it is loose, whether it is normally consolidated, it is over consolidated like that. And based on this, we try to understand which state that soil is. And one of the very important point here, or the kind of parameter to understand the state of stress is your over consolidation ratio, OCR. That as compared to the pre-consolidation stress, where are we now, or the stress level now? So that is one of the parameters. The other parameter is what we see here is critical void ratio. We talked about over consolidation ratio, that is related to the consolidation, and what is the stress in terms of that. Now here we are talking about if it is loose soil or dense soil, if we apply stress to it, then both loose and dense, they will try to converge at one point, and that they will reach a point where the void ratio is same for both, almost converging both for dense and loose. So that is critical void ratio. And when we try to plot, this is in log, hence the plot is straight line. Otherwise you will be having a kind of curved line. So this line, the critical void ratio line, gives us the understanding whether the soil is non-susceptible to liquefy or susceptible to liquefy. So this is again sigma dash 3c, that with respect to void ratio, so that the shearing stress or the stress that we are having with respect to the void ratio will give us the understanding if we plot severe line, critical void ratio line. Next, this is just what I explained already, that what exactly this critical void ratio is, that when we apply the deviator stress with respect to axial stream, then the loose ones are just going, and the void ratio from here, let's say the axial strain beyond this for both loose and dense is same, they're converging. So that is EC, that void ratio refers to EC, the critical void ratio. And this void ratio is for the loose ones, loose soil, the same soil in loose state, same soil in dense state, soil remains the same. So that is what we are having. The next, what I was saying, that this is the deviator stress, the dense one, the other one, other way of calling it as the dilative one, they dilate, the volume of that increases, and the loose ones, the other way, contractive ones, the volume of that, when we apply deviator stress, they contract. So that leads to, and when we try to plot, we have a kind of a boundary, that is critical void ratio line. And that ratio we can, how we find here is, I was trying to drop it, but otherwise the concepts will not be clear, hence it is there. But again, this is also there in all the liquefaction chapters, everywhere in all the books, the reference list is given in the end. So if we don't understand this severe line, then it will not be easy to understand the concepts. The susceptibility criteria will not be clear to us. And one of the very important is the state criteria. So now assume the soil is in dense state and it is now seared in undrained condition. Then what happens, that your void ratio is not changing, void ratio remains same, and it reaches here, doesn't it is here now with respect to the sigma 3c. If it is a drained one, the stress doesn't increase, but the void ratio increases. That's the, in case of loose ones, if it is undrained or drained, it will be having the same, if it is undrained one, it will have the same void ratio. If it is drained one, the void ratio will be decreasing. So void ratio is increasing means it, the volume is increasing, it is dilative. Here the volume is getting reduced. The void ratio is getting reduced, hence the volume is getting reduced or contractive. That was the point. Is the right one is this exactly same figure in log. So when we have this curved line, if we plot it in log scale, we get this. This plot also you must have seen in our earthquake engineering when we plot that Gutenberg Richter relationship, that magnitude and number of earthquakes. When you do that, if you put that in linear scale, you have the curved line. You have in the log scale, you have the straight line, and then you find the A and B parameters, the seismic parameters you try to find out. It's exactly the same. The plots are the same in the left and right. Only point I try to make is this critical void ratio line helps us to understand the state of soil, whether it is loose or dense, loosely saying. And this also tells us whether it is susceptible or not. Now, this was all about when we talk about all these things. The critical void ratio line and all this, this was all done when undrained test was not available. Only drained experiment, the triaxial test that we were doing that time, were not having the facility to do undrained experiments. So what happened when this Castro himself and further Castro and Polas in 1977, they introduced this steady state concept by doing the experiments using undrained, means you are not allowing the water to come up, this to put it simply. So that based on that, they had this, that what type of soil, suppose loose sample, dense sample, you have the medium dense sample, and at constant shear stress, volume, effective stress and volatility condition, all these conditions are maintained, then based on the type of soil, the state of soil, we can understand whether the liquefaction will be the phenomena or not, or it will be dilating, or it will be having limited liquefaction. So that we can get. And these are kind of deviator stress with respect to strain and pore under pressure, or your P versus Q. Now, based on that, we get the steady state line, which is below the critical void ratio line. And this, now the updated one is the creating steady state line is the boundary for susceptibility, and this tells us about the flow liquefaction. So this flow liquefaction and cyclic mobility are the two types of liquefaction that depending upon the state criteria also, so this happens, that the liquefaction happens. But the kind of liquefaction happens depends on the state criteria, and they are broadly classified as this, flow liquefaction and cyclic mobility. So in this case, that the static shear stress, which is there required for the stability, is greater than the shear strength of the liquefied soil. Then what happens, for example, I'm trying to explain it. Suppose we have the hilly, hills, it's a kind of slope. We have a slope in the horizontal, not a leveled ground, but kind of slopy ground. In that case, the soil anywhere in that inclination, that cord line, will be flowing when the amount of static shear stress is greater than the shear strength of the liquefied soil. The static stresses cause the flow failure. It's just kind of we have landslide, mud flow. Okay. The cyclic mobility is the case when, this is little conceptual. So without going to the state concept, state criteria in detail, it will not be very easy to understand, but I'm trying to put it in a very generic way. So the cyclic mobility occurs when static shear stress is smaller than the shear strength of the liquefied soil. In that case, what happens? The cyclic and static. Cyclic, which is coming because of the ground shaking that we are having. So ground is shaking and the static shear stress is also there. Both are responsible for this liquefaction. And in that case, what we see, the cracked grounds, that the ground is having multiple cracks, in case of lateral spreading, so kind of pieces. So that will be the phenomena which we will see in the ground after this liquefaction. So the one approach would be to take all the questions in the end, or the other approach would be to take in incremental way. So I would prefer to take both ways, but given that time will be limited, I am just going to the next part. Honestly, I would prefer to take questions in parts, but we are skipping that question answer in between, which I don't know how long it will take. So because of that, I'm taking all the question answer sessions. Anyone is typing any question in the chat box, I'm not reading anything. No, nothing is there. So I'll take all the questions in the end, if time permits, of course, because I'm having less time and the topics are quite broad. So now the next part, after we understood that when it happened, what happens, or what is the liquefaction, why does it happen, we are now will try to understand how to assess it. So now in this flow chart, we'll try to understand what exactly we are trying to evaluate, that whether this ground is liquefiable or not, this soil site is liquefiable or not, is our objective here. So in this flow chart, you see, there is a site, engineering site, why we are calling it, because there are so many sites. We are going to a site where some engineering constructions, civil engineering constructions are going to take place, hence the engineering site. Now, there is earthquake action. There is earthquake irrespective of the kind of zone we are in. So you refer to your IS 1893-2016, and obviously one of the sessions by Professor Murthy was also on that. So you have the earthquake. Now, because of this, what do you try to understand? That you try to assess the triggering or the initiation of soil liquefaction, that initiation, that whole concept I actually left. I just tossed it because of the time constraint. We didn't talk about the initiation concept so deeply. It's really a huge chapter in itself. Sorry. So what we are trying to understand, we have the site, there is earthquake of a given magnitude. We have to decide which magnitude earthquake is supposed to be considered. Again, to consider, I'll take some water now. Sorry. So, given the location we are in, given the zone we are in, we have some understanding based on the past earthquakes. So that will give an understanding of how big that earthquake is likely to be in terms of magnitude or intensity. Mostly magnitude, and that too moment magnitude. So that we consider. Based on that, we try to understand whether the liquefaction will be triggering or not. If there is no likelihood of liquefaction, then we declare risky. It's not easy to declare because so many uncertain parameters are there. If at all the parameters are taken well, then we declare, no, this site is safe. Again, I repeat, dangerous statement, very bold statement to make. Never ever try to do this mistake. Because we have so many uncertainties, just to name a few. In ground motion parameters, we have so many uncertainties. The magnitude, the source characteristics, path characteristics, site characteristics, so many hundreds of parameters are involved, and the tests that we are having, whether it is SPT, CPT, DCPT, or that is called BPT, or your shear velocity calculation, again, different types of instruments we use, hundreds of uncertainties are there. Plus our own uncertainty that we can have. So based on all those uncertainties, which we say that this site is safe, is again a bold statement. So better we should calculate with all the details mentioned. Then we should put the name that yes, it is factor of safety. The number is saying this is safe, but to tell that this is safe is quite not a good statement. Anyway, if it is yes, if it is going to liquefy, then what we do, that assessment of liquefaction resistance based on the in-situ test. Resistance in the sense, how much is the capacity of that soil, capacity of that site to resist the earthquake loading, the ground shaking. And that we'll try to understand based on multiple in-situ tests, the field tests that we do. There are multiple field tests that you know, but these four are used for soil liquefaction study. Standard penetration test, cone penetration test, dynamic cone penetration test, or this is Baker penetration test, then the shear wave velocity test. So there's these things that SPT and CPT again are quite broadly used, or I should say SPT is mostly used because the CPT is quite expensive. And SPT again, although we are using, it is quite erroneous. If you know this kind of setup, it is quite erroneous. So based on that, we need to understand what type of test we are doing, the errors that it may have, and the corrections that we are supposed to take. These are again, all the corrections involved in all types of tests are again different topics. We'll try to touch it and touch and go kind of will do. Now, after doing all the in-situ tests, if we see that there is no danger, then perfectly fine, the site is safe. Then if there is danger, then the site, we try to calculate the liquefaction index, or the other way, site liquefaction potential index or factor of safety, which we will define and discuss later. Then how much is the deformation to be expected? Deformation estimation of the liquefied sites. So this could be probabilistic, this could be deterministic also. Then if there is possibility of liquefaction, in this particular topic, we will try to talk about liquefaction treatment. Treatment done to the soil. There is also the other part, that is treatment done to the structure. We'll touch and go. So in that case, so when we understand that these are the ones, based on that, we'll do the experiments and all this. Now, these are the field tests that we talked about. There are also lab tests that we can perform. For example, we take the soil sample, we give that cyclic loading or the kind of earthquake loading we can have in the shake table to try to liquefy the soil or try to see whether the soil liquefies or not. But the problem there is, when we go for the lab test, the major problem is that we don't get the soil sample as it is. The soil sample could be so much disturbed, because getting the soil sample of different depths, we need soil sample obviously, but they are supposed to be undisturbed. Then only we can understand the state of the soil and we can do the experiments to get the information related to liquefaction likelihood. So now we are trying to understand what exactly should be the number. Based on that, we'll say that yes, this soil is going to be liquefiable, going to be liquefied or not in future earthquakes. Again, when I say future earthquakes, our factor of safety will be dependent on the kind of magnitude we are going to have. Or the so in that case, to put that factor of safety, everywhere we use this term, factor of safety. So it's basically capacity to demand. So there was a topic I saw, that performance-based design. There also we talk about the capacity and demand. So that factor of safety is that of ratio of capacity to demand. How much is the capacity that soil has to resist the soil liquefaction to happen, and how much is the demand coming from the ground shaking or from the earthquake. So to put it that way, that it is resistance to loading. We can calculate this. We can calculate this based on two approaches, cyclic stress and cyclic strain approach. This cyclic stress is broadly used. What is done there, that the loading and the resistance both are expressed in terms of cyclic stresses. So loading imposed on soil by the earthquake and resistance of soil to liquefy. to liquefaction, both are characterized in terms of cyclic shear stresses. In cyclic strain approach, both loading and resistance are characterized in terms of cyclic shear strains. Just a question, I don't know whether it is because of the net, because every time I see someone is leaving, it's because there is any issue from my end, my speed is a little fast, or whatever, it is a general phenomenon. So I'll take it as a general phenomenon that people are leaving. But hopefully not that they're writing and I'm not responding, hence they're leaving. No. Okay. Now coming to this the same equation, we are putting it again little mathematical way, that capacity, demand, resistance, loading, we understood. Now this resistance, again, as we saw, as we said, is the cyclic stress to liquefy, and the loading, again, it is the cyclic stress. So that we are trying to understand. Now what we are trying to do with this cyclic stress, in the next step, we are trying to normalize by dividing effective overburden pressure both to resistance and to loading. So by doing so, we get CRR, cyclic resistance ratio at depth Z. So when I say depth Z, even here also, when I say effective stress VO, what it means is that we are talking about at depth Z. Somewhere we have fixed our depth, or our intention to find the factor of safety is at a particular depth. It is depth dependent, function of depth. So that FS, when we say, that is also function of Z, depth. So at particular depth, how much is the cyclic resistance ratio? What it means is capacity of soil to resist liquefaction. The next one is cyclic stress ratio, that is at the same depth we are supposed to find out. Otherwise, the demand and capacity cannot be one at the bedrock and the other at the surface. So it should not be that way, obviously. So when we try to do that, we have to take the cyclic shear stress at exactly same depth where we are trying to do the CRR. Next, what exactly we do? Here, so many things. Although the equation, I had five slides, I brought it down to one. So please, I'll try to do a justice, but it is so compressed. Given that we have very less time, it's already 10. Now, in this cyclic stress ratio calculation, why we are doing this? Our objective is to find this tau cyclic. Then only we can normalize with respect to this initial vertical effective stress to find out cyclic stress ratio. Okay. So to do that, what we need to do is that the site response analysis, or simplified method. Site response analysis, or the other way it is called, ground response analysis. We have multiple ways to do it. If you refer to any of the books in geotechnical earthquake engineering, or even in seismic microzonation that we talk about, when we talk about the seismic coefficient, right? So there, what we do, we use this site response analysis. I have no more slide on that because this topic is not about that. So it's just a word. I'll try to explain it and go. So what we do is that we have the soil column, layered soil, and we are giving the excitation, the acceleration time history, the input ground motion at the bedrock level, at the bottom of the soil column. And then we try to propagate the wave through the soil column. Corresponding to that, we try to find out the deformation, the stress, strain, everything, acceleration at every depth. We can do it using linear analysis, nonlinear analysis, or in between path we can choose, that is equivalent linear analysis. This is single word, I'm still on that same word, site response analysis. It is done for a reason that I don't, if I have multiple slides, I'll be wasting my time. So when we have these three approaches normally, that a linear site response analysis, equivalent linear site response analysis, or nonlinear site response analysis, what is our objective? To find the acceleration time history, acceleration or stress or strain or deformation along the depth. That is the objective. Mostly what we do in this site response analysis, that we try to find out the deformation at the surface level. And we compare that with respect to bedrock. By doing so, we try to know what is the amplification. How much is that ground motion is getting transmitted, which is again from completely structural dynamics, that we calculate the transmissibility of force or displacement. So similarly, here we try to find out how much is the deformation at the ground surface. We compare, then we get the amplification ratio or the site coefficients that we use in our design. Here I stop. So here what we do, that site response analysis we can do if we have the complete soil profile. Generally we have, otherwise we generally don't go for soil liquefaction study. We have the complete soil profile. If we have the stress directly calculated there, we can use it. Else what we do, we use the simplified method. Simplified method is quite old one. Seed and Idris, they recommended this. And the very principle of this equation is based on the rigid block, shearing a rigid block. So when we have something like tau, so this again, 10 slides put together. I'm not trying to confuse you, but it's the fact. So when we try to calculate tau, it's nothing but our force by area. So force is again MA by area as it is. So that M by area, if we multiply Z in the bottom and top, numerator and denominator, then we'll be having that gamma Z. And this gamma Z is analogous to that M by A. So that gamma Z is nothing but initial vertical total stress. Initial vertical total stress that we know from soil mechanics. That, or when we remove the pore pressure, that becomes effective vertical, initial effective vertical stress. That is for the, I was explaining this one only, tau. This is for the normalizing part that we talked about earlier. So that is from this. Next, if you remember, M by A and A, that A is nothing but from this A max by G, and G is to normalize again, acceleration due to gravity. And this peak ground surface acceleration, that we can find it from the site response analysis that we talked about, or based on the codes that we are having or the zones that we have. Again, the errors will be associated with this if you do that in a very generic way, because the peak ground surface acceleration, surface level ground, surface level spectral acceleration or just the acceleration are going to be different horizontally. So just taking one number for the whole zone, we have four zones and you just pick one number for that whole region, it is not doing justice to it. So if you do height response analysis, it's perfect. Else you take that A max value, put it here, sigma V, sigma dash V, you calculated, these two things are done. Next, why 0.65 G? No, sorry, why 0.65? Now, what we are talking about here is this equivalent uniform cyclic shear stress, what we refer to here, all these are with respect to the earthquake that we are going to have. But this one is with respect to the cyclic uniform cyclic shear stress. So when you convert from one to the other, 65% of that is to be considered. So this is what it is written. Equivalent cyclic shear stress is equal to 65% of the peak cyclic shear stress. Okay. So because of that, it's based on the study. Next remains, when you see, when we did that rigid block and we applied shear, this is purely strength of material, what I was explaining, tau is equal to F by MA. So that when you apply the shear stress, the assumption was it was a rigid block. But the in reality, soil is not rigid. We know it. Soil is not rigid. And you have the shearing somewhere. So along the depth of soil, the behavior is going to be different. So along depth, there will be reduction. That reduction is because our, I repeat, our initial assumption is based on the rigid block to which we applied shear stress. Then we got this formula, this tau cyclic is equal to all this, not the sigma dash V, VO, but the rest of the others, A max by G sigma VO up to this. Then what we know that soil is flexible, deformable all over. Even that kind of deformable property we study in strength of material or mechanism material is different what we talk about in soil. So whatever it is, now this reduction is taken into account through this depth reduction factor. So all these symbols are probably well understood now. So this is finally cyclic stress ratio. And depth reduction factor we can calculate based on this. Where is, what is the depth? This we can use if our depth is less than 9.15 meter, or if it is 9.15 to this, we can calculate accordingly. Or we can use the chart depending upon the depth that we are having. Now, this is depending upon the for different soil profile. Correct? So as you see, what you do, you take the average and we take that depth reduction factor, or simply you put that if you are programming, if you are trying, programming you will be having difficulty also, because if you do some mistakes, because somewhere we have to take the data from the charts also. So direct programming, for example, MATLAB programming is not very straightforward. So whatever it is, now RD is used. Then we have the CSR calculated. Next is, when you calculate CSR, that CSR is with respect to a particular magnitude and the overburden pressure or the stress level. That is to be corrected also, because our magnitude is not going to be 7.5. Our magnitude is going to be different. 6.5, 5.5, 6, 6.1, whatever it is. So our magnitude is something different. So that needs the correction. So for that, we use this magnitude scaling factor, dimensionless, it is normalized. Then K sigma, overburden stress adjustment factor, dimensionless again. So these two, this equation may confuse you sometimes. The reason is sometimes CSR is calculated the way we discussed here. CSR is equal to 0.65 A max by G sigma VO by sigma dash VO RD. Then this is associated with CRR. CRR is multiplied with MSF and K sigma and other correction factors. That is doable, that we can do. Else, we can divide this MSF and K sigma to CSR. Either way we do it is fine. But the point is MSF and K sigma are supposed to be below when we are calculating factor of safety. Now, what is CRR? So many equations, and I'll try to just talk about what exactly is the story, not to confuse you more. What exactly is cyclic resistance ratio again is about the capacity of the soil. We can use any of the tests that we talked about, SPT, CPT, VS, also BPT or DCPT. Where your DCPT is limited to gravelly soils, And the correlations are quite less. The database for that BPT or DCPT is quite less, given the fact that the number of liquefied sites in gravelly soil is quite limited. Hence, the relationships are not very much well established. So, but these three are well established in one sense. Here, given the time constraint we are having, what we will do, we'll just limit to SPT. As the name suggests, it is standard penetration test. It's particularly what you have. You have the sampling rod, you are having the hammer, you have the head on which you are hitting. Manual way of doing things. Now, using that, we are trying to calculate. So if it is against for 7.5, we'll have to do the corrections. Either way you do it. So based on that, again, this equation you will find in different ways. So when different ways and the equations are getting updated, so this particular equation may not match any of the old textbooks. Whatever it is. Now, coming to this, that CRR is equal to all this, what you see is N160CS. N is the number of blow counts that we are having when we do the SPT test. So you have particularly that 1.5 meter depth I need to go into, depending on the kind of the code you are referring to. So based on that, you calculate how many blow counts. Again, the mistakes are very much likely. The person who is counting may make mistakes. Once he or she enters the number, you have no record to correct it further, assuming the numbers are counted properly. And the measurements are supposed to be taken at regular interval. Sorry. Now, here you have N, then you do the corrections to those calculated blow counts. So they are kind of CN, the correction factors, that is, correction for SPT blow counts. After you apply those correction factors, there are many, not just one, there are many. So that is actually a chapter in itself. So I'm jumping so many things here, skipping so many things here. So you have so many corrections involved, because what I mean, just to briefly tell you, that when you have the SPT done at a site, the rod you are using, the length of the rod, the sampling tube you are using, or the kind of hammer you are using, all these things are quite important. And what depth you are. So all these factors are supposed to be considered. Then your correction, blow count will be correct. So your N160CS is the corrected blow count. And for that, we need, again, some alpha and beta N160. CS is again for the fine contents that we are having. So fine contents, if it is within the range of 5% to 35%, or if it is greater than 35%, our alpha and beta values are accordingly calculated, and they're used in this calculation of N160. So they are the correction coefficients. FC is the fine coefficient. And again, this fine coefficient we will calculate based on the sample collected and tested in the laboratory. In that grade size distribution, how much is the fine content? We cannot just see the soil and say that this is the fine content. We have to collect sample also and do the test. So that when we do, finally, all these expressions are put to find CRR. Cyclic resistance ratio. Now you see the blow count So whether it is cyclic stress ratio or cyclic resistance ratio, either way you can have. In corrected blow count, your fine contains, so SPT clean sand, is the term, SPT clean sand base curve. And as we are talking about clean sand, so obviously we need to know how much is the fine content, because clean sand we talk about, if we don't talk about how much is the fine in this, then obviously we are making mistakes. Hence the fine content correction is supposed to be taken into account. That's the point. So we have this curve, we can use this also. And there are also updated ones, like you have N160, that is blows for feet, again, depending upon the kind of reference you have, feet or meter you have. That is, based on this, we'll get to know that what is our line. So based on what is the fine content, we can interpolate, extrapolate, whatever we do. So based on that, we'll decide how much is our CRR value. Next, after we calculate all this, we'll be getting factor of safety. I should have put one more slide to summarize that after our CSR is calculated and CRR is calculated, what we are supposed to do to calculate factor of safety, FS. FS is to be calculated along the depth. Now, that factor of safety will give us an hint, give us an idea about whether that site is liquefiable or not if we calculate liquefaction potential index. Why liquefaction potential index is important? Because when we try to find out factor of safety, it's at a particular depth. If that depth is quite insignificant to make any disturbance to the soil on the top or the structure on the ground, then why to bother? For that reason, we need to know the severity at the site. So what it quantifies is liquefaction potential index quantifies the severity of liquefaction and predicts the surface manifestation. Because so we are concerned about the surface damage, not that whether 50 meter below whether it is liquefying or not. Again, we should study it. We must study it because we have multiple types of structures. Depending upon the structural type, our liquefaction study is done or the site response study is done. So it is not generic that factor of safety has at a depth has nothing to do with the surface or the structure on the ground. It has. But the point is, if it is a residential building of less weight, low rise, and the liquefiable layer is quite deep, then why to bother? That's the point I'm trying to make. So here what we have, that severity is quantified in terms of liquefaction potential index. That what we do, you have this 0 to 20 that we're trying to calculate the midpoint of the soil layer, 0 to 20 meter, and DZ is the differential increment, the way we do general integration. Because we are doing this way, because the soil medium is continuous, it is in continuum. So FZ, and this FZ is 1 minus factor of 50, is the probability, kind of. So the 1 minus factor of 50, and what we do in case of, one more thing, if our factor of safety is less than 1, we say it is liquefiable. If it is greater than 1, it is non-liquefiable. If it is greater than 1, then the whole LPI has no meaning. It's 0 and then it is 0. So means there is low potential index, no low severity, the other way. So that's what we do, and we put the wetting factor along the depth. At what depth we are, because we are normalizing, right? The 0 to 20 meter we are putting. So based on that, we find the severity. So I just some mismatch you'll find after that. Because the one more slide, the computing side is supposed to be there, but it's just reversed. So now, whatever it is. So now the LPI, when it is calculated, depending upon the value we have, 0, 0 to 5, 5 to 15, above 15, we have this very low severity or little to none, nothing will happen to the surface, or low to minor, minor manifestation, that soil will be, that the building will be slightly tilted or slight, just minor, then moderate, then very high or major. So these are the things. So this is what I was saying, the slide was supposed to be in the previous, but this is the old one. Anyway, so what we are supposed to do after the CRR and CSR, I talked about this, but so after this CRR, CSR is calculated, we try to understand what is the depth where the layer is having factor of safety less than one. If it is greater than one, then there is no liquefaction. So that is what we discussed. Now comes the liquefaction mitigation technique. So in fact, I'm running late, I know, but we are doing 3-4 subjects at a time, 3-4 big topics at a time. So please, and because of that, I'm also a little fast. I was planning to be a little slow also. Now, after we understood that the soil is liquefiable, we cannot just leave it as it is. We have to do something about it. And what we can do is generally called the remedial measures against liquefaction. So we have multiple options. The first one, that strengthen the structure, which is the theme of this conference, which you studied, the performance-based design, the codal provisions, and the retrofitting, etc. I don't remember the whole set of topics, but the theme is actually about earthquake resistant building. So that's what you do first and foremost and most important. If that is not possible, or in addition to that, depending upon the criticality of the structure, if it is a lifeline structure, then in that case, treating the liquefiable soil is also very important. Then to prepare auxiliary facilities, we'll probably not touch that. This is again broad. Next, again, this is for touch and go. Structural strengthening to mitigate the liquefaction potential. Well, most important thing we can do is structural strengthening, or the theme that we said, that earthquake resistant building or the seismic resistant building are supposed to be designed, constructed. In this picture, for example, in this house of cards, the name house of cards says that the just a small gust of wind, it will fall apart. Everything will fall on the ground. More or less, most of the structures are like this. So many structures, so many. So now what we need to do in this seismic resistant building, because I'm running late. So in this, what we do to make seismic resistant, we need to know that what is the structural type, what is the earthquake ground motion, what is the ground, the dynamic analysis is to be done, then the design accordingly, considering all the 13920 or whatever, your 1893 course, etc. Then our objective, just to come here, our objective is to make the building fully operational, immediate occupancy, life safety, collapse prevention. You studied that definitely in other talks. Now, after you have all this, just making the structure is not sufficient just for earthquake resistant, to make it earthquake resistant, because there are many other forces also which are likely to be affecting the structure in its lifetime, in its service time, service period. So like wind pressure, windborne debris, there is cyclone. Cyclone is few days back, there was cyclone, even on the west and in the east, both sides. So there, so wind pressure and windborne debris, something is flying and hitting the building. That should be resistant. Hydrodynamic pressure, if there is so much flood, that water will be having that dynamic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure due to flooding and floating debris. If there is strong wind during cyclone, like this time it was, what is that? I forgot the cyclone. but was in Odisha and West Bengal, that side. So it was having the wind of 145, 150, 60 kilometer per hour speed. So there, you will be having so many complex interactions like positive pressure, negative pressure, vibration, stagnation, overturning, drag, drift, uplift, so many things to the superstructure. Now, one thing we don't see is here in this, or the generally ignored, is the foundation, which is most important. And the foundation stability is also very foundation, strong foundation is also very important for a strong structure. It's very, very important. Otherwise, it is impossible to have a structure. For that, we need to understand the type of soil. To understand that, after understanding the type of soil, we have to decide what type of foundation we need to have a seismic resistant building, or all these wind resistant building, cyclone resistant building, or any normal building, but resistant one, safe one. Fire resistant building is not our topic in this case, because there is a different kind of load. So in this, the foundation is supposed to be strong one, and with respect to the type of soil. So we can go for the piling or pile draft, all these things in this case, which is very important, because just having the superstructure, the very strong, what do you call, beam column joints is not enough to have a stable structure, safe structure. The next one, to treat liquefiable soil. Dr. Kumutha has suggested me to be on time, and I have exceeded the given time already. I'll just summarize, because I'll try to make justice to this, but a little faster.
No issues, Professor. You can just take some 15 minutes more also. No issues. Yeah.
No, with all due respect to your instruction, I'll follow. So I'll just do it. I hope I'm in the track, no?
Yes, yes.
I wish to make the, being a teacher, of course, all of us want to make the class interactive. This monologue actually kills me, literally. But I'm doing it because a sword is hanging on top of my head that the time is running out. In our regular class, if one section is not over, then we take it to the next class. So let the discussion go on and on. So that luxury, that privilege is not there. So anyway, to come here, to treat liquefiable soil. Objective is what? Objective is to increase the density, void ratio is supposed to be decreased, obviously. If it is decreased, then only the density will increase. Either way, you understand. Solidification of the ground, adjustment of a ground, grain distribution that we have, we understood that this is the uniform type of soil. Okay. And what we can do, we have to make adjustment. Like we have to replace the soil, or we have to mix something with the soil so that the soil grain distribution will be adjusted. Lowering of degree of saturation, like lowering the ground water table, because that water is the problem. No, water is definitely not water, is life. What I mean is water is the problem in causing the liquefaction during ground shaking. So if we have lowered groundwater table or the lowered degree of saturation, if the soil is partially saturated somehow, the dewatering is happening in that case, liquefaction will not be the case. Dissipation and control of pore water pressure. If there is pore water pressure generated, excess pore water pressure is generated, that won't be excess if there is possibility of dissipation, but that pore water pressure is supposed to be drained, dissipated, controlled. If that we can do, then we can mitigate the liquefaction. Then increasing the effective stress. Effective stress, because effective stress goes down or becomes zero, leading to reduction of strength and stiffness, or making the soil liquid type. So because of that, our increase of effective stress is very important. Next one, control of shear deformation. Generally, it is not very easy to do because it's kind of ground excitation. But we'll be trying to do some of this. Now, some of these techniques that increasing surcharge, that most of these, what you are having here, this whole thing, it will definitely look like I'm running so fast. It has to, because this exactly what we are talking, the list is again much longer. And this is a course in itself in MTech. It's a graduate course, 4-credit course, that is ground improvement technique. And almost all the techniques are useful in treating the liquefiable soil. So in 10 minutes, 5 minutes, I cannot do justice, I agree. I'm sorry for that. But the point we try to do is, these are our objective. Objective has to be kept in mind, then the process will follow. We have wide variety of options. Now, surcharging. When we do that, by doing this, for example, when we surcharge, I'll take a little water. I'm sorry. So, when we have this ground, some level ground is there. Now, we know that what is the total stress, what is the effective stress, overburden pressure, initial total stress, initial effective stress, that we know. If I add something extra on top of it, what is happening? The total stress is increasing, the effective stress is increasing. You can see in the same expression that CSR, CRR, if you put that extra term both, your factor of safety will be different now. Okay, the factor of safety will be increasing. If it is, let's say, 1.5, it will become 1.8 because of the surcharge. So in that way, this helps in mitigating the liquefaction. The next one, drainage or dewatering that we talked about, that excess pore pressure is supposed to be removed. Because when there is ground shaking, it's a kind of, so many people are there in under the tent, and one person shouts that, oh, there is a snake. Everyone tries to fly and run away, and there is only one exit route, so there is stampede. And leading to that, all these boundaries are broken, everything, and too difficult scenario. Similar happens here. If we have the exit route proper, and this we have maintained that this is the route to go out, similarly. So this is the kind of arrangement done. So we have the weak drains, stone columns, that we can have that stone columns, in the sense we have this excavation done, drilling done, and we are putting the stones. And what we are trying to do, we are trying to get water into it, and then we can pump it out if we are trying to do it. So drainage is facilitated or dewatering is done. Next is the dynamic compaction. So what we are trying to do, that again, we are trying to increase the density. So what we are trying to do in this case is that we are dropping the weights from desired height, depending upon the crane height and the kind of compaction we are going to have. Again, it's not easy everywhere. As you understand, when you drop a heavy weight, the nearby structures are likely to be affected, will undergo vibration. So they may, that may lead to legal issues also. So it's not every time possible, but if it is possible, it is open ground, nobody is there, we can have this, that we drop weights, and when it hits, then we'll be having compacted grounds, and we'll be having this. We have to decide, it's not just random. We have to decide what should be the kind of distance between these compactions. So they, accordingly, how much will be the vibration created? Or what are the nearby structures present? How deep we want to compact? All these things will decide. And accordingly, how much should be the weight and how much should be the height will decide. Long topic. The next one, vibroflotation. So we can have, it's a kind of vibrator that we have in our compacting the concrete in the column. So similar to that, so we have the soil, we have the vibroflot that is inserted into the ground, and we are trying to compact, we are having this. So the that compaction and this vibration is trying to increase the density of the soil. It's, next, I'll be stopping here, given that it is almost 40, that the piles
are also useful in liquefiable layers. If the soil is liquefiable here, as you see, then we can have the pile going deep into the soil up to the bedrock level. By that, we will be getting the end bearing capacity, of course. The other thing is that it will not be, again, this liquefiable soil, even if it is hitting up to the bedrock, there is possibility of severe damage, because the ground in that case, if it is moving, if the soil is not treated, the pile foundation, there are many buildings which were damaged in past earthquakes because of the pile foundation damage also, because this will be kind of leading to lateral force on the pile foundations if they are not taken into account, or if they are not designed to take care of the lateral loads, then it will lead to severe damage to the foundation and also to the superstructure. These are the references, key references. There are many, of course, and because the figures are not cited, most of them are very generic. You will find those figures in almost all the textbooks. Even they, with not citing it, before I share the slide, I'll try to put the citations because it is otherwise not proper. But these are the key references that we used in this presentation. So this is quite all these are quite generic, and the, of course, the coincidence is the soil liquefaction during earthquake. Again, see, Idris are the famous ones, and here Idris and Bulunga. The title remains the same, and our topic and this are exactly the same. Anyway, and all the books or everything that you see here are really good ones. And if you are interested to understand more, please refer to these books. And a big thank you from my side. I know I didn't take any question during the presentation. Now I'll be happy to take one or two, depending upon the we'll probably stop at 45, maximum 50. So now the question, if you have any. Should I stop sharing, Professor Kumuda?
Yes, yes, sir. So now the it's open for discussion. So participants, if you have any questions, you can type it in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and you can raise your questions.
There is something in the chat box. Just a second. Mr. Chayan Viswas is saying, generally, if the bearing capacity of soil is found low, we use sand to increase the bearing capacity. But if sand particles are higher susceptible to liquefaction, then what can be done economically? Chayan Viswas, it's not a general practice to increase the, I don't know what is the context and where. It's not just a general practice, as I understand, that you can increase the bearing capacity of soil just by using sand. So if you can elaborate more, that will actually help. The other part of the question that you are writing, what is economical? Yeah, economical, it is not going to be economical in many of the situations, but you have to do it depending upon the type of structure you are going to have. So criticality of the structure, if it is a lifeline, if it is, for example, it's a hospital, if it is a bridge, if it is let's say a nuclear power plant, or wide variety of structures that you are going to have. It's an embankment, it's a dam. Dam, obviously, you want to go to a site which is liquefiable. So depending upon that, economy is probably not a very important thing. Economy will probably not do justice to this. So I hope I answered your question. And coming to the first part of this, your Anusha, I'll just complete the previous answer. So the sand, when are you using sand? It's before the construction of the building? Or the other question I have, counter question is, or after you find that the structure is having settlement, and you are doing underpinning and you are putting sand below. Sand below is probably not general practice to my knowledge. There could be, but I don't know. Next. So Anusa, so what is the difference between geotechnical earthquake engineering and earthquake engineering? Wow, I love it. So thank you, Anusa. It is, as you rightly write, that the only word that you have in difference is geotechnical. But actually, if you see any earthquake engineering book, you start with our, S.K. Dugal, right? They also have the initial part exactly same as Kramer book. Okay. So, Jitesh, I'll just, if time permits, I'll go to you, but I didn't read your question yet. So now, the primary difference here is our focus is about, if you just briefly talk about wave propagation through the soil medium. That is one important. Prior to all this, what you have in the Kramer book or any other book, even in structural earthquake engineering book, is about geology, to understand what is earthquake. Why should you understand? Because we are interested to know the ground motion. Without understanding, ground motion is actually not our business. It's the geophysicist, seismologist, they talk about it. And again, our objective from those whole set of ground motion, our objective is strong ground motion, not just any ground motion. Okay, so strong ground motion is our objective. That is not part of actually part of geotechnical earthquake engineering. In geotechnical earthquake engineering, which keeps it aside from earthquake engineering, is that the how the soil behaves when the ground motion is passing through this. Depending upon the soil type, again, I will briefly introduce that there are different soil types. It's not just medium soil, soft soil, or clay. There are multiple classifications, like any HRP classifies the soil. I'll go a little slow. It looks a little odd just to take more questions. I may not be a little hurry. So I'll be slow. If it's okay, I'll take 2-3 more questions. So, but message should be clear. So now what we are trying to do is that just putting the word in a very generic way that soft soil, hard soil, medium soil, the way you have it in IS 1893-2016, it's very difficult to put the boundary. So what also this one says, your any HRP, they suggest that depending upon the soil shear wave velocity, VS, that you understood in your introduction to earthquake engineering or other topics also, or you might be knowing as well already. So that will give you the idea whether it is A, B, C, D, E, and F. Okay. If it is F type, you go for the detailed investigation, and that detailed investigation, even D, E, wherever you are, which type of soil you are having, the kind of investigation you will be doing is the part of geotechnical earthquake engineering. In that, a huge part is from soil dynamics, like dynamic soil properties. We talk about soil properties everywhere. So that is quite important. So a huge portion is also from that, soil dynamics. In earthquake engineering, we start with the vibration. The initial chapter will be the introduction to vibration in earthquake engineering. But here it will start with introduction to soil dynamics, because we need to understand structural property, also the soil property, both. So that is roughly put. But again, there is very narrow difference. It's very, because objective is the same, to have the safe structure. The next question, Jitesh Kumar. I hope Anusa made some sense, but it is a long answer. I wanted to keep it short. Jitesh Kumar, why we generally use local sand other than general soil up to plinth level soil filling? What could be problem if we use general soil? First of all, this question is outside the context of what we are discussing. Because if we talk about plinth level thing, it is about construction engineering, or the other way, building construction, so which is not our domain. We didn't introduce the topic, and it's not correct to answer that question here. But just to tell you that why we use local sand other than general soil. So the reason, again, when you have soil, again, it's very generic way of putting it. It's not the general practice. So even if we do it, the reason is we can easily compact sand. If anybody is doing, that is the objective. If you have a vibrator, you can easily compact it and it will become dense before you have that ground floor on that. If you are putting a slab for the, many people also put a slab for ground floor as well. We are doing that. Because otherwise you will be having a void. If it is not thoroughly compacted, you will be having void. So that void is supposed to be avoided. If you have a void, if you just walk on that, you will be having some noise. Throughout your life, you will be hearing. You are in the ground floor, but when you are walking, you will hear the sound. So it has to be completely intact with the ground floor slab. This floor it should be intact with. If it is soil, what will happen? Soil will take so much time to consolidate and settle. Even if you put water, even if you vibrate it, it takes years to consolidate. It has a long time requirement, which you cannot wait for. So that is generally the reason. But again, I repeat, this is outside the context of the topic that we are having today. But it's a good question anyway. Next question, please share the email ID. My email ID is my name only, jagabandhu.dixit@snu.edu.in. Thank you. Then Jitesh Kumar, thank you. Any other question or we'll stop here because I was supposed to complete in 100 minutes. Thank you, Professor Somotha, and thank you everyone. Thank you literally everyone for giving me this opportunity to talk to you. And as you know, the broad domain civil engineering, or to keep it specific, earthquake engineering, or to make it further specific, geotechnical earthquake engineering. My experience of 14 years is nothing. It's nothing. It's a mustard seed, but the whole field is a mountain. So because of that, and our time was also very limited in that, whatever I could do, I tried my best. If there is any more doubt, you may write emails. I'll share the slides, you go through them. And very important, I am trying to make the questions public. Not actually, that all the questions that you saw, okay? When, why, where, what, you put some other extra words. That is the primary objective in this topic. If you understood that, why, when, how, where, then that serves the purpose. Thank you very much. So Hari, Dat, many thank yous are there. Mohit, Ansari, Mary, Anand Kumar, Raghunathan, Sumit, Sarik, thank you so much. World is round, we'll meet some other time, definitely. Thank you so much. Professor Somatha, over to you. Professor Kumatha, over to you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So I'm Ruby Freya, co-coordinator. Thank you so much on behalf of Department of Civil Engineering, Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, and all the participants. Thank you very much for this lecture. It was very good. And thank you for clearing the doubts very clearly and patiently. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Professor Freya. Thank you so much. And I thank every participant who took part in this. Thank you so much. And
thank you, Dr. Dixit. Yeah, for your wonderful session. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Kumatha, for inviting me, for allowing me to talk to